Let's pray together. Now, Father, as we look at Jesus, not only in the New Testament, but also in the Old, help us to see his eternal nature and all that he did to come to this world, to this earth, and live among us, and then to die for us, and to rise again from the dead. Give us an understanding into the big picture here. Speak to us as we open your word. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Well, the title of this series is The Greatest Stories Ever Told. And we've been in the Old Testament for 31 messages. Now we're shifting gears and we're coming to the New Testament. And so this is the greatest of the greatest stories. Why? Because this is the story of Jesus Christ. Effectively, the entire Old Testament is pointing to this story. This is the fulfillment. This is the big event. This is what everything is really focused on in the Bible. So we're going to talk a little bit about the birth of Jesus in this message. And I don't know if that's legal to speak on the birth of Jesus in the month of October. I think you can only do it from December 1st on, but I'm going to break the rules and actually give a kind of a Christmas message here in the month of October. But I love this story. I never get tired of it. I never get tired of telling it. And when we think of the Nativity, when we think of the Christmas story, our mind really races to Mary and Joseph and Bethlehem and the shepherds and the wise men. But the real Christmas story goes back way further than that. In fact, the first mention of Christmas or the Nativity or the birth of our Lord was actually B.C. Now you might ask, well, how's that possible? Doesn't B.C. mean before Christ? Well, yes, but the story of redemption started long before Bethlehem. The story of redemption started in a garden a long time ago. And the Christmas story actually begins with a tree. You might say it's the first Christmas tree. Not like the ones that we go and buy and decorate, or maybe you have a fake one that you drag out every year, which I have finally succumbed to. I now have fake trees. They look very real. But I'm not talking about that Christmas tree. This is a mysterious tree. This was a tree that people were forbidden to even be near. This tree is called the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and it was in the Garden of Eden. We all know that the Lord placed our first parents, Adam and Eve, in this literal paradise. Radiant beauty at every turn, exotic wildlife, perfect temperature, and best of all, no sin or the guilt or the shame that accompanies it. And the Lord God himself would show up every day to take a stroll with his buddy Adam. Now, how much better does it get than that? And there was only one prohibition that God gave to Adam and Eve. Don't go near the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And straight away in the Genesis account, where do we find Adam and Eve? Hanging out by the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Isn't that just like us? I mean, with our children, we'll say to the kids, don't go in that room or don't look in this box. And the next thing you know, they're going to be in the box. They're going to do the thing you tell them not to do. You know the rest of the story. They ate of the forbidden fruit. And sin entered into the world. So now they're ashamed and they're hiding themselves. And the Lord shows up as he always did. And he calls out, Adam, where are you? Adam responds, well, we heard your voice and we're naked and we were ashamed and we hid ourselves. And the Lord said, who told you you were naked? Have you eaten the fruit I commanded you not to eat? Now, why was God asking this? Was it because God was ignorant, didn't know what was going on, needed to be updated? No, it's because God wanted Adam to confess his sin. He wanted Adam to come clean and say, it's my fault. But Adam did not come clean. He did what we often do when we get caught in sin. We don't take responsibility. We blame someone else, right? Well, it's not my fault, you see. And what does he do? He throws Eve under the bus. And he did it before there was even a bus to throw anyone under. He said, it's the woman you gave me. Now, I wonder how he said that. Did he say, it's the woman you gave me, putting the blame on Eve, kind of implying that, you know, I was laying around sleeping, I wake up, her rib's gone, and this chick's here. And or did he say, it's the woman you gave me, sort of putting the blame on God? hey, this wasn't my idea. This was your idea. I was happy hanging around zebras and antelopes and fish. And no, no. Well, I don't know which one it was, but he wasn't taking responsibility. Now, here comes the first Christmas verse in the Bible. It's not Isaiah 9:6, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. It's not Micah 5:2, you Bethlehem, though you be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of you will come forth one whose origins have been from everlasting. No, the first Christmas verse is Genesis 3:15, where the Lord speaks directly to Satan and says, there is coming one who will bruise your head and you will bruise his heel. He says to the serpent, I'm just laying this down right now. I'm officially announcing it. The Messiah is going to come and he's going to crush your head, but you'll bruise his heel. So game on. And the devil knew it. And the devil knew that not only was Messiah coming, but he knew Messiah would come through the Jewish people. And so we see the concentrated efforts on the part of Satan to stop Christmas, if you will, from ever coming. We've all heard of the Dr. Seuss story, The Grinch Who Stole Christmas. Well, there's the devil who tried to steal Christmas. That battle starts in Genesis and continues throughout the Bible to the book of Revelation. Going back to the book of Exodus, and there's the Pharaoh giving the order to kill all those Jewish baby boys. Why? He was trying to stop the Messiah from coming. Then we fast forward to the story of Esther that we looked at recently, and there's the wicked Haman with his plot to eradicate the Jewish people. And of course, Haman ends up hanging on the gallows he had prepared for another. That plan backfired. And then we come to the New Testament, and the wise men from the east come looking for the one who was born, who is called the King of the Jews. And they mention this to Herod, who, by the way, had been also described as the King of the Jews by Caesar. Herod, being the paranoid tyrant he was, completely freaked out. And finding out that Messiah was to be born in Bethlehem, he had all those baby boys put to death. So this is the devil's attempt to stop Christ from coming. But again, we want to remind ourselves that the Messiah comes, but he is not coming for the first time in Bethlehem. He pre-existed. Well, how so? Because Jesus is God. He has neither beginning nor end. So we have to go way, way back to get the big picture on the Christmas story. So that brings us to the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. Without him, nothing was made that was made. In him, verse 4, was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Then verse 14 tells us that the Word came and walked among us. The Word is speaking of Jesus. Now, there is not a definite article before the word beginning here in verse 1, meaning you cannot pinpoint the moment of time where there was a beginning. So we're going back to eternity past, further than our minds can imagine, which brings us to point number one about Jesus. Jesus is God. Jesus is God. Before there was a world, before there were planets, before there was light or darkness, before there was matter, before there was anything, there was the Godhead. And there was Jesus as a part of the Godhead, a part of the Trinity, of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Jesus Christ is co-equal, co-eternal, co-existent with the Father and with the Spirit. He was with God, we are told in verse 1, he was God. Jesus was deity in diapers. It's true. God became an embryo. It's kind of mind-boggling when you think about it. Born of a woman and sent to this world. He entered our world. He breathed our air. He shared our pain. He walked in our shoes and then some. He lived our lives and then he died our death. No, Jesus did not become identical to us, but he did become identified with us. In fact, he could not have identified with us any more than he did. It was total identification on his part without the loss of identity. He became one of us without ceasing to be himself. Philippians says that he came in the likeness of sinful flesh. He was a human. He had emotions. He had hunger and thirst and sorrow and all the things we experience as humans. Yet at the same time, he came to us with his divine nature intact. There's not a moment that Jesus became God. He always was God. He was God before Bethlehem. He was God in the womb of Mary. He was God in the manger. He was God as a young man. And of course, he was God when he went to the cross. He didn't give up his deity. He only veiled it. But he never voided it. The word was with God, verse 1. This is interesting because this phrase could be translated, the word was continually toward God. The Father and Son were continually face to face. The preposition with bears the idea of nearness along with a sense of movement toward God. I was just looking at a little baby in the back here, the daughter of Gabe and Tiffany, sweet little girl named Paisley. And I got up really close to her and I said, hi. And she turned away and went, ugh. See, we were face to face and she didn't like it one bit. But see, Jesus and the Father are face to face. That's the implication here. That is to remind us that there was the deepest equality and intimacy in the Trinity. Jesus himself said in John 17, Father, glorify me with your own self with the glory I had with you before the world began. You know, so this is such an amazing thing to think about. And then that he walked among us as a man. It's mind-boggling. That brings us to point number two. Jesus, who was God, became a man. Now, when we think of the first Christmas, we think about the birth of Jesus, and it was. But you could just as easily call it an arrival as well as a departure. Yes, it was a birth. It was a real human birth like any other birth. However, it was a departure from heaven. A decision was made in heaven that God would come and walk among us as a man. And really, Isaiah 9:6 sums it up perfectly. Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. And the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. From our perspective on earth, a child was born. From God's perspective in heaven, a son was given. So he comes and he walks among us. The Creator is walking among us as a human being, because we're told in verse 3 of John 1, all things were made through him. Without him, nothing was made that was made. Colossians 1:16 tells us that all things were created by him in heaven and on earth. You know, this is just mind-boggling. John writes in his epistle, that which we have seen and heard, we declare unto you, that you may have fellowship with us and have this fellowship with God. It's an interesting phrase, because when he says seen and heard, the phrase for heard could be translated, it's still ringing in our ears. Have you ever been near something very loud that went off like an alarm, and you hear it after it stops? It's ringing in your ears. So the apostles are saying, man, we can still hear his voice. We can hear the tonality. We remember the inflection of his voice. We can still see his face. We close our eyes, and we can still see it in our mind's eye, and we want to talk to you about him. I mean, how wonderful would it have been to actually walk with Jesus? You wonder sometimes if when he fell asleep and woke up, all the apostles are standing around just looking at him. That's God right there. That's God in human form. But it was. God became a man. But I want to think a little bit about appearances of Jesus before the incarnation. Incarnation is just another word for his birth. We might call them pre-incarnate appearances of Christ, also known as Christophanies. You ever heard that word before? A Christophany is an appearance of Jesus before Bethlehem. And he made a number of them. Now, how many there are, I suppose you could debate it. I'm going to give you some of them, of what I believe are appearances of Jesus in the Old Testament. And by the way, Jesus himself alluded to these Christophanies. When asked in John 8 if he was greater than Abraham, Jesus said, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. The Jews said to him, you're not even 50 years old, and you've seen Abraham? Jesus said, most assuredly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. Get that? So Jesus is saying, oh yeah, I knew Abraham. We hung out. We talked to each other. Really? So we know straight away Jesus appeared to Abraham. And Jesus himself said it. Then you remember, after the Lord died on the cross and rose again from the dead, he made an appearance to two disciples leaving Jerusalem on the Emmaus Road. And as they walked together, he began to open the scripture to them. And we read in Luke 24, 27, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, Jesus explained to them what was said in the Old Testament scriptures concerning himself. And I wish I could have heard that conversation. When I get to heaven, I'd love to say, Lord, would you just go over that for me? And I want to see what I missed. So we know that Christ appeared in the Old Testament in a Christophany. We know that Christ was referring to verses that spoke of him. So where are these Christophanies? Well, let's start with Abraham, because we know he appeared to him. The story of Abraham and Isaac on Mount Moriah comes to mind. That's in Genesis 22. You remember that Isaac was born to Abraham and Sarah very late in life. And Isaac's name meant laughter. And he brought a lot of joy to his mom and dad. He was the light of Abraham's life. That's why when God came to him one day and asked the impossible, it's so amazing Abraham was able to do it. God came to Abraham in Genesis 22 and said, Abraham, Abraham said, yes, Lord, here I am. God says, take your son, your only son, yes, Isaac, whom you love so much, and go to the land of Moriah, sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains, which I will point out to you. Now, you know how the story ends, and you know that Isaac was not sacrificed. This was a picture. God never asked for human sacrifice, but he allowed this to give us a picture of Christ and to teach us a very important lesson. It was a test for Abraham. So as Abraham and his son Isaac are making their way up, and Isaac is carrying the wood that he's going to be placed on to be put to death, son says to father, Dad, where's the sacrifice? And Abraham prophetically says, son, God will provide himself the lamb for a burnt offering. So the two of them went together. Now, if that is not a picture of what happened at the cross of Calvary, I don't know what is. Here are father and son, Abraham and Isaac, working together to obey God. And here are father and son with the Holy Spirit working together to accomplish God's purposes. The father is making the ultimate sacrifice in giving his son. The son is making the ultimate sacrifice in laying his life down. And by the way, most commentators believe Isaac was 18 to 20 years old at this point. Josephus, the historian, thought he might have been 25 years old, and another commentator thought around 33. Which would be the age of Christ when he died. However you look at it, he wasn't a little kid. Because sometimes in the paintings and in the film depictions, it's like Abraham taking this tiny little boy up there. No, Isaac was effectively an adult. He was a young man and a strong one. And Abraham was an old crotchety dude, okay? So at any point, Isaac could have been carrying the wood like, hey, Dad, I'm just kind of thinking, you're kind of old and I'm young. Why don't we sacrifice you, you know? I mean, really, how much longer do you have? Like 8 minutes? So the thing is Isaac, this strapping young man in the prime of his youth, was willing to lay his life down. So let's not take away from that. Yes, the father, Abraham, was willing to offer up a son, but the son willingly went, and is that not what happened at Calvary? Yes, the father sacrificed his son, the greatest sacrifice. But don't forget that Jesus said, no one takes my life, I lay it down of my own accord. Well, as Abraham is preparing to plunge the knife into his son, suddenly he is stopped and he hears an angel say, don't hurt the boy in any way, for I know you truly fear God. You have not withheld even your beloved son from me. I want you to know, Genesis 22, 12, it is not an angel, but the angel of the Lord. And the angel says, you have not withheld your beloved son from me. Sometimes when we read angel, it's not necessarily an angel. I believe this is a Christophany. I believe Jesus Christ stopped Abraham from sacrificing Isaac. But Jesus Christ also knew it was not far from this very location that he himself, fast forwarding in history, would lay his life down for us. So that's one Christophany, I believe. And we know Jesus did meet Abraham. Number two, another Christophany would be the wrestling match between Jacob and the angel. That's also in Genesis 32. Old Jacob was quite the conniver. He'd have been a good used car salesman. Sorry, that's what you do. But, you know, he was always negotiating, always working out a deal, and he always benefited from the deal. I know people like that. You know, you never want to negotiate with them because you're going to lose. But if you need someone to negotiate for you, they're a great friend to have. And that was Jacob, always working the deal, always trying to work it out for his benefit. Now he had a brother named Esau, and they were twins. They were womb mates. And normally, in biblical times, the firstborn would become the heir of all the blessings in the family. And the firstborn in this case was Esau, who was covered head to toe in hair. By the way, the name Esau means hairy, literally hairy. And that's because many times when they named their children, they would name them after what happened at birth. Well, this kid's hairy. Let's call him Harry. So literally, that's what it meant. And Jacob, Yaakov, means heel catcher, because when Harry came out, Jacob was hanging onto his foot. Oh, look, he's hanging on his heel. Let's call him heel catcher. But God reversed the order. And instead of the younger serving the older, which was the norm, God said, no, I'm going to reverse it around, and I'm going to give the blessing to Jacob, not Esau. Well, old Jacob couldn't wait on the Lord. He took matters into his own hands when his father was getting old and senile and couldn't hardly see anymore. Jacob actually covered himself in hair from some animal, and he fooled his dad into thinking it was Esau, which shows you how hairy Esau was. And Isaac, the father, gave the blessing to Jacob, thinking he was giving it to Esau, and then Esau was so ticked off at him, and they had a sibling rivalry that lasted for a lifetime. So now old Jacob is running for his life. He had effectively fought with God for years and years if he had just trusted in the Lord. You know, there are always people that want to play politics, and you got to manipulate this, and you got to do this. You know, and I've always just felt, no, what we need to do is honor the Lord and do what his word says, and he will open the doors for us. And Jacob didn't believe that, and so he really reaped the consequences of it. So when we come to Genesis 32, and you can turn there if you like. I know I've had you mark two other scriptures, but hey, let's splurge. Let's go to a third, if you like, but I'll read it to you. But there in Genesis 32, 24, we read, Jacob was left alone, and a man with him until the breaking of day. Now when he saw he could not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint, and he wrestled with him. And he said, let me go, for the day breaks. And he said, I'll not let you go until you bless me. And he said, what is your name? He said, Jacob. And he said, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have struggled with God and with men, and you've prevailed. And Jacob asked, saying, tell me your name, I pray. And he said, why is it you ask my name? And he blessed him there. And Jacob called the name of that place Peniel, for he said, I've seen God face to face, and my life is preserved. I believe this is a Christophany. I believe Jacob is not wrestling with an angel, but with Jesus himself. Now, I think Jesus sort of humored Jacob a little bit, let him score a point or two, then pinned him until he said uncle or savior. And this would be like you going up against Hulk Hogan, right? And so, you know, he lets you get a few moves in, but he's going to body slam you and it's going to be over with. Or maybe it's like me wrestling with my grandkids, you know. They'll grab me and act like they're pulling me down, and I'll let them pull me down, but actually they aren't, you know. And that's what was happening. God was humoring him. The fight went on until Jacob went from cunning to clinging, from resisting to resting. He started out fighting with God, and he ended up hanging on to God. And he said, I won't let you go until you bless me. That's what the Lord was looking to. And sometimes we're fighting with God, aren't we? God says, I want to do this. No, you know. That says, okay, let's go for it. And you know, he'll let us have our little wrestling matches, and we'll resist him, and we'll do whatever it is we do. And then they'll kind of pin us, and then we'll come back for more. And finally, we realize, I am tired of fighting with God. I want to just submit to his will. That's what Jacob did, and his name was changed from Jacob to Israel. And he wrestled with God. What did he say? This place is called Peniel, for I've seen God face to face. Wait, Jacob, you are wrestling with an angel. No, Jacob says, I saw God. I think he saw Christ. Here's another reason I think that was a Christophany. Because later on at the well that Jesus showed up at, where that woman was, remember her who had had all those husbands, five in total, and was living with a guy? And he engages her in conversation. And she says in John 4:12, are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us this well? How can you offer better water than he and his sons and his cattle enjoy? Man, Jesus could have said, oh, please, give me a break. I wrestled with him. He was a total lightweight. He didn't say that, but greater, he encountered Jacob. I think also the story of Samson has a Christophany in it. You know, Samson didn't end well, but he sure started well. And the Lord came to his parents, Manoah and his wife. They were unable to have children. So this angel shows up, presumably an angel. Judges 13 says, the angel of the Lord appeared to Manoah's wife and said, even though you've been unable to have children, you're going to become pregnant and give birth to a son. And that son was to be the mighty Samson, who would be a judge over Israel. So Manoah's wife tells him what happened. This angel, this man of God showed up. And so Manoah prays, oh, Lord, come back again. And so the man of God appears again. And so they ask him the question in Judges 13:7, what is your name? Because if this comes true, we want to honor you. And the angel of the Lord said, why do you ask my name, seeing it is wonderful? And as they were bringing an offering to the Lord, suddenly the angel ascended in the fire, and both Manoah and his wife freaked out, and they said, we have seen God. I think this was a Christophany. They saw God, they said. And here's the interesting thing. They asked the angel his name. He says, why do you ask my name? It's wonderful. Wait a second. Where have I heard that? Back to Isaiah 9:6. You will call his name Wonderful, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father. There's many other Christophanies I could mention. This reminds me of a scene from the film The Voyage of the Dawn Treader. These are the C.S. Lewis stories that were brought to film. And actually, that was my favorite of the three. And so in the movie, we have Lucy and Edmund encountering Aslan. And of course, Lewis was very upfront in saying that Aslan was a picture of Jesus Christ. So there's this powerful scene where they're in Narnia, which is sort of a picture of heaven. And Lucy and Edmund are being told they have to go back to Earth, you know, back to that wardrobe. Remember, they went to that wardrobe or that closet and went into this imaginary world of Narnia. And they're told they're going to have to return to Earth. And Lucy, through her tears, says to Aslan, it isn't Narnia, you know, it's you. We shan't meet you there. How can we live never meeting you? And Aslan replies, they will meet him back on Earth. And when Edmund asks whether he is there on earth too, Aslan says, yes, I'm there, but I have another name. And you will know me by that name. And Lewis was simply pointing out that this is a picture of Jesus. And so he appears in the Old Testament. But now, of course, we see him coming to us in the New Testament. Certainly in the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that had to be Jesus hanging around with the three Hebrew holy boys, right? Remember, Nebuchadnezzar throws him, we just read about this, into the fiery furnace, and he says, I threw three in there, and I see four, and the fourth one looks like a son of the gods. That was Nebuchadnezzar's pagan way of saying, there's some other guy walking around with them in there. And I believe that was Christ himself. Christophanies, appearances of Jesus in the Old Testament. But now we shift gears, and we come to Luke chapter 1. This is the story of the actual birth of Jesus in the New Testament. Let's start in verse 26. Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. Having come in, the angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." When she saw him, she was troubled at the saying, and considered what manner of greeting this was. And the angel said to her, "Don't be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and you will call his name Jesus. He will be great. He'll be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father, David, and he'll reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end." Then Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, seeing that I do not know a man?" The angel answered and said, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you. The power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore, the Holy One who is born will be called the Son of God. Now, indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is her sixth month for her who is called barren. For with God, nothing will be impossible." Mary said, "Behold the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. We'll stop there. This miracle of the arrival of Messiah came through a virgin birth. I think you've all heard that popular talk show host Laurie King was once asked who he would choose to interview. If he could interview one person throughout human history, and he said, "Yes, I would interview Jesus Christ. And I would ask him, are you indeed virgin born?" Larry King says the answer to that question would explain history to me. That's very insightful. And of course, Jesus was virgin born. And when you stop and think about it, there is no other way that God could have accomplished his goal. I mean, think about this for a moment. There's a lot of ways that God could have sent Jesus to this earth, right? He could have just been born of two earthly parents. Not supernaturally conceived in the womb of Mary, but rather just the conception of two parents. But then it would have been very hard for us to believe he actually had a sinless nature. Or then again, Jesus could have come down from heaven in a shaft of light. I mean, just the clouds open up and the light hits the ground. He just comes floating down. "Hey, everybody, here I am. I'm ready to start." But then if that would have happened, how could we have related to someone like that? Now, when you stop and think about it, the virgin birth is quite logical. It was God's way. And by the way, I would add, if Jesus was not supernaturally conceived in the womb of Mary, then he was not God. This is not a peripheral issue. This is not a secondary issue. This is basic Christian theology. If you're a Christian, you must believe Jesus was born of a virgin. Supernaturally conceived in the womb. Let me take it a step further. If you don't believe that Jesus Christ was supernaturally conceived in the womb of a virgin named Mary, you can't be a Christian. "Well, that's crazy." No, I don't think it is. Because Jesus said, "Unless you believe that I am, you will die in your sins." See, if he wasn't conceived in the womb of Mary, then he was not divine. He was just some guy saying he was divine. It had to happen this way. So this is not, as I said, a secondary issue. He was fully God, yet at the same time, fully man. Listen, Christ was God, not because he was virgin born. He was virgin born because he was God. Dietrich Bonhoeffer said, and I quote, "If Jesus Christ is not true God, how could he help us? If not true man, how could he help us?" End quote. So it's like he's true God, he's true man, fully God, fully man. No one has ever walked this earth like Jesus. That is why he and he alone was uniquely qualified to bridge the gap between a holy, flawless God and sinful humanity, because there's never been any prophet, guru, or anybody else who was God in human form. And who did God choose to be the person who would have the privilege of being the mother of the Messiah? A girl named Mary. Now, the problem with the Christmas story is we romanticize it and we sanitize it. And I think in the process of doing that, in some ways, we neutralize it because we don't appreciate it in its grit, in its edge, in its reality, because it's more powerful when you see it as it actually happen? So you think about this girl, Mary. Who was she? Well, she was a peasant girl. She was a very young girl. Most commentators believe that Mary was around 12 to 14 years old, really a young kid. And you know where she lived? She lived in Nazareth. Nazareth was not a nice place to live. In fact, Nazareth was renowned for wickedness. It was a place where Roman soldiers hung out. It was a place that was known for immorality. So here was Mary, who managed to be a moral girl in an immoral place. I mean, you think you have it hard, girls? Well, she had it much harder than you have it. Because they didn't even have the standards we have, and ours are pretty lax. But in these days, the Roman soldiers pretty much did what they want, grabbed who they wanted. You know, the Jewish people were looked upon as their servants or their subjects. And so to live a godly life, to be pure, to still be a virgin living in Nazareth was a feat unto itself. But this was a godly woman. But also understand, Nazareth was sort of a non-place. It's kind of one of those places that you go through on the way to another place, like Barstow. Who goes to Barstow? You stop in Barstow to get fuel and In-N-Out Burger, right? You get back in your car and you keep driving. Maybe you go to the outlet stores. Are they still there? I haven't been there for a while. But, you know, it's not like, we're going to Barstow for our vacation. You keep driving. That was Nazareth. So here is this non-place. And here is a nobody. Mary was a nobody. She was a nobody in a nothing town in the middle of nowhere. Have you ever felt that way? I'm a nobody in a nothing town living in the middle of nowhere. Well, you know what? Maybe you are. But you know what? God specializes in taking nobodies and turning them into somebodies. He specializes in working through human weakness. 1 Corinthians 1:26, a modern translation, a paraphrase, puts it this way. Take a good look, friends, at who you were when you were called into this life. I don't see many of the brightest and best among you, not many influential, not many from high society families. Isn't it obvious that God deliberately chose men and women that the culture overlooks? God chose those nobodies to expose the hollow pretensions of the somebodies. Think of all of the nobodies God used through Scripture. David the shepherd boy, overlooked by his own father. Gideon the frightened farmer, used to be a courageous warrior to lead the Israelites into battle. Peter the outspoken fisherman. The list goes on and on. Why does God do this? Because 1 Corinthians 1:28 says, God chooses things despised by the world, things counted as nothing at all, and uses them to bring to nothing what the world considers important, so no one can ever boast in the presence of God. See, the reason God does this is so when something good happens, the people have to say, only God could have done that. Because if you're the most talented and the most beautiful or the most handsome or whatever, people are going to go, well, I always knew they would do something. I mean, look at them. But when it's to somebody who wasn't that talented and isn't that great looking and isn't the one who was at the top of their class and was actually overlooked, and God says, I'm going to take that person and I'm going to put him here, then God gets the glory. It's been said, if you see a turtle on a fence post, you know he didn't get there by himself, right? And so God takes people and he puts them in this place and you say, how did they get there? Why are they there? They don't deserve to be there. That's true. But God said, I did it, so I'll get the glory. That gives hope to us, doesn't it? 9 months later on Christmas Day, who was the news of the birth of Messiah announced to? Well, if it were me, if I were God, I would have sent the angels into Caesar's court, Caesar in all of his power, sitting on his royal throne. But God didn't do that. God had the news announced first to shepherds. Now, along with everything else in the Christmas story, we've romanticized shepherds. You know, we think very highly of shepherds because David was a shepherd and Moses was a shepherd, and shepherds were keeping watch over their flocks by night when the good news of the arrival of Christ was announced. But in biblical times, a shepherd, they were at the lowest of the social order. And they were like, they were lower than telemarketers. I don't know what to describe, you know, compare it to, but they were the lowest. Nobody wanted any, and I'm sorry if you're a telemarketer. I've offended all the used car salesmen and telemarketers tonight. So, and if you're a used car salesman who also is a telemarketer, this is a very hard sermon for you. You may be the exception to all these rules. How many of you are telemarketers? Okay. Really, we have one here? Wow, that's good. Okay. Quick favor, stop calling me at 5 o'clock. I don't even want to ask how many used car salesmen. Okay, so it was announced to shepherds, which shows that God went out of his way to take the lowest of the low and elevate them. Because God doesn't see things the way we see things. Oh, that person there. Oh, God says, you know what? I favor that person then. Those down and outers, those people no one cares about. I'm going to come to them and I'm going to impact their life and I'm going to use them so I get the glory. God chooses this young unknown girl living in a relatively unknown city to bring about what would be the most known event in human history, an event that would forever divide human time, B.C. and A.D., the birth of Christ. He finds Mary in Nazareth, but of course the birth takes place in Bethlehem, another small place. Micah says, you Bethlehem, though you be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of you shall come forth one whose origins have been from everlasting. Listen, maybe you're living in a wicked environment. You know, you're under a lot of pressure. Where you work, where you live, a pressure to have sex before marriage or to be unfaithful to your spouse, pressure to go party, pressure to compromise, pressure to lie, pressure to cut corners, whatever it is. You say, it's really hard, Greg. You don't know what it's like. Wait a second. Mary was able to do it, and God will give you the strength to live a principled, godly life wherever you are. And he can keep his hand on you and use you in a powerful way as well. What is the essential message of the incarnation? What is the essential message of the birth of Christ? The primary message of Christmas? Here it is. It's that we're not alone. God came to us. You shall call his name Emmanuel. And what does that mean? God is with us. And God's always been here, but that doesn't mean he's in us. He's here, but he's not necessarily in you. The only way Christ can come and live in you is when you admit you're a sinner and ask him to forgive you of your sin and invite him into your heart. I love that old Christmas hymn that we often sing. Let every heart prepare him room. Hark the herald angels sing. So, we have to prepare him room. We have to say, Lord, please come into my life. You know, we had our friend Dennis Egajanian and his wife over recently, and we have a guest room. The problem is it's filled with all the toys for the grandkids and their granddaughters. We have a grandson now, so we're trying to balance things out, but we have a lot of pink stuff. We have dollhouses, and we have American Girl dolls, and we have furniture for the American Girl dolls, and we have all this stuff, and then we have a little fabric pink house that the kids play in, and so here's the bed over in the corner. We're saying, gee, I hope you like pink. We tried to prepare the room for them, but there was a lot of pink in the room, but then they managed to get through the night okay, though I did come in, and I found Dennis curled up in the dollhouse, which is... No, that's right, I made that up. But I'm definitely getting off script here. Okay, so let's reel it back in. But you know, you prepare room. We prepared a room for them, in effect. You prepare your heart. You say, Lord, come into my life. Be my Savior. Be my Lord. Be my God. Have you done that yet? Have you invited Jesus into your life? He came to this earth on a rescue mission. He came to this earth to die. Remember that first Christmas passage? He will bruise your head, God said to Satan, but you will bruise his heel. Jesus came and died on the cross, and the Bible says that he was bruised for our iniquities, and the punishment for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. He died voluntarily for us, just like Isaac was willing to lay his life down with his father, but didn't have to. Jesus did lay his life down, and there was no last-minute reprieve. There was no stop issued by an angel. The Father had to bring the knife on the Son, in effect. The Father had to pour his wrath upon the Son because there was no other way for us to be forgiven. But then Jesus, who was God, didn't stay in that tomb. He rose again to life, and he's alive and ready to come into your life right now. And if you've never asked him in, I want to give you an opportunity to invite him into your heart as we close now in prayer. So let's all bow our heads and everybody praying. Father, I pray for anyone here who may not yet know you. They've not yet invited Jesus to come and live inside of them. Lord, would you help them to do that? Help them to see their need for you. Help them to find your forgiveness this night, we pray. Now while our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed and we're praying together, how many of you would say, Greg, I want Jesus in my life. I want him to forgive me of my sin. I want to go to heaven when I die. I'm ready to say yes to Jesus now. If that's your desire, if you want Christ to come into your life, if you want him to forgive you of your sin, would you lift your hand up right now wherever you are and I'll pray for you. Just lift your hand up and I'll pray for you tonight. You want his forgiveness. You want to go to heaven when you die. God bless you. Lift your hand up where I can see it, please. And I'll pray for you. God bless you. Just lift your hand up wherever you are. God bless you. Anybody else? God bless you. Anybody else? You want his forgiveness tonight? You want Jesus to come into your life? God bless you there in the back. God bless you as well. While our heads are still bowed, maybe some of you would say, you know, there was a time I walked with the Lord, but I've fallen away from him. But I want to come back to him again tonight. Pray for me. If you need to return to the Lord, would you raise your hand up and let me pray for you right now? God bless you. God bless you. Anybody else? God bless you and you and you. All right, now I'm going to ask you that have raised your hand, if you would, please. I want you all to stand to your feet, and I'm going to lead you in a prayer of commitment to Jesus. Again, if you raise your hand, just stand to your feet. Even if you did not raise your hand, but you want Christ to come into your life tonight, just stand up. That's right, stand up. You're not the only one standing. Others are standing right now. Stand up. You heard me right. Just stand in your spot right there, and I'm going to lead you in this prayer that I'll have you pray right where you are. Anybody else? Maybe you did not raise your hand. You can stand. If you did raise your hand, stand now, and we'll pray together. God bless you that are standing. Anybody else? Stand now. You want God's forgiveness. You want Christ to come into your life. Stand to your feet, and I'll lead you in this prayer. One final moment. Anybody else? Stand now. God bless you. Anybody else? God bless you. All right, you that are standing, I want you to pray this prayer out loud after me. And this is where you're asking Jesus to come into your life. Again, as I pray, pray this out loud after me, okay? Pray this after me now. Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner, but you died on the cross for me and shed your blood for my sin. I turn from that sin now, and I choose to follow you from this night forward. Be my Savior and my Lord. Be my God and my friend. Thank you for coming to this earth and being born in that manger and dying on that cross. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you that just prayed that prayer. Amen. God bless you.